Good morning, everyone. Wake you up there. Yeah. Before we get started, I want to just talk about one announcement. There's the prayer vigil out there. There's a sign-up sheet, and there's just a couple more places left. So get in there and sign up while the getting's good. And it's a wonderful experience, just a really intimate worship experience for that. So if you've never tried it, think about that. And I'd like to start with a verse from Hebrews today. And this is all one sentence. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, for whom be glory forever and ever. And that's a verse that I like to pray over family, that second part especially there. And I'm going to just read that one more time. May the God of peace equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. So, I pray that for our church today and each other, and then be on the lookout for what God is doing. So let's stand and sing this morning.
Thank you. we pray. We give thanks, O Lord, for the hope we have in Jesus, who died but now is risen and rules over all. Because he lives, we look for eternal life, knowing that nothing past, present, or yet to come can separate us from your great love made known in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
No kids today. Okay. I'll just have to pretend. Okay. I'm gonna hold on to this. Have you ever lost anything? Man. Yeah. Lots of places have something called a lost and found. And at our house, there's a lot of these kind of things. I'm not even sure which one this belongs to, but this was in the lost and found. Sometimes we have a lot of these around the house, missing the partner. Not sure where the other red one is. Sometimes these are in the lost and found. I've gotten to the point where I need a pair of these in my car, in my husband's car, in the house because I want to go outside, but then I need them in different rooms because I lose them in certain rooms. So I go to the dollar store and I just buy a whole bunch of dollar glasses, and that's what I use because I have a problem with that. We have a lot of socks, a lot of socks with no matches. I don't know where they go. I don't know how that happens, but we have a whole bunch of them and they don't match anything. I can set them out on the table and there's no matches. I don't know. It's just crazy. Oh, and then every once in a while we have a missing shoe. That'll work. Oh, and then we have game pieces. Sometimes we lose the game pieces and we have to find some new game pieces to play our game. But, you know, pens and pencils are always getting lost. And I know that there are some things that are more precious
than other things. If you lose a sock, it's not so great. But our Bible story today is about something that was lost and it was very precious. And it's found in the book of Luke in the Bible. And it's a story that Jesus told all about what it's like to lose something and then find it again. How do you feel when you lose something that you really, really love? And then if you find it again, how do you feel then? And our story is about a man with two sons, and Jesus told this to his followers, and he wanted to teach them a lesson. See if you can hear what the lesson is in this story. Jesus said that the two sons that belonged to the man decided one day, well, one of the sons decided that he was going to talk to his father and say, "Dad, I don't want to live here anymore, even though this is a wonderful place to live, and we have servants, and there's money. I know that when you die, I'm supposed to get some of your money, and I'd like to have it now." And the father wondered, "Why do you want it now?" And the son said, "Well, I want to go out and I want to experience the world. I want to see places. I want to do things. I want to do whatever I want. So I want my money now." Well, the father reluctantly gave him his part of his money, and the boy went off to experience the world. Well, in Jesus' story, the boy made some wrong decisions. And he wasted his money, and it wasn't long before his money was gone, wasted completely. In fact, he didn't have any money to buy food, and so he had to get a job. And the story goes that the boy had to get a job feeding pigs. Now, I don't know if you've smelled pigs before, but pigs have the most putrid smell ever of anything that I have ever smelled ever. We used to have pigs. We don't have them anymore. It was a horrible smell. I can't even imagine being the one in charge of feeding the pigs. Well, the story goes that the pigs were eating their food one day, and the boy just sat there so sad because he remembered his past life. He remembered what he used to live like at his father's house. Meanwhile, the father was at his house and he was very heartbroken because his father loved him very, very much. And as he would get up in the morning, he would look down the street and hopefully he would see his son coming, but he never did. And the father watched for him daily. The son was sitting with some pigs and he was so hungry that even the pig food looked good to him. He made a decision. He said, "You know, I think that my father's servants eat better than what I'm eating, and they live better than what I'm living. Maybe if I go home and I ask forgiveness and I tell my father that I'll come and I'll be your servant. I'll be a servant. If you'll just let me come home, maybe I'll be able to get some food and I'll be able to get forgiveness." And he went back home. And his father saw him coming because he had been watching every single day. And the boy came back and he said, "Dad, I'm really sorry for what I did. I'm sorry that I made some wrong decisions. And I want to come back and be your servant. Will you let me come back and do that?" And his father said, "No, you're my son." In fact, he wasn't just happy to see his son. He threw a party. And they had a party, and he told his servants to get a party together, and they celebrated that his son was home. His brokenhearted father was so loving to him and loved him so much that he was willing to bring him back and to forgive him. And this story was being told because Jesus wanted to tell people about how much his Father God loves them. And even when his children stray and make some wrong decisions, that God always accepts you back. And that not just will he accept you back, but he is so happy to have you back that he does look for you and wants you to come back to him. And so let's pray and thank God for being unconditional in his love and for being never-ending forgiveness, having never-ending forgiveness. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your unconditional love, and thank you for your unending forgiveness. Thank you that we can come back to you, and you will accept us back, and we can ask your forgiveness. And I ask that you would help us to remember to love others like that too. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning to all of us that braved the elements this morning. We're going to celebrate the fourth Sunday in Lent. In preparation for our two readings this morning, let us just take a few moments, bow our heads in silence, and relax our minds, open our hearts in preparation for our reading. Free us from the tyranny of the familiar, Lord. Let us not take things for granted. Shield us from the temptation to think that we already know what it is you have to say. And instead, sweep through our hearts with your Holy Spirit so that we will discover anew our place at the celebration. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from the New Testament, and we'll be reading from 2 Corinthians. It's chapter 5, verses 16 through 21, and it's located on page 938 in your pew Bible, or, of course, follow on the screen. A reading from 2 Corinthians. Titled, The Ministry of Reconciliation. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, and the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin, so that in him we might find the righteousness of God. These are the words of our God. Let us hear them, study them, and then incorporate them into our daily lives. Amen.
Our second lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Luke. It's Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 3, and then 11 through 32. It's found on page 848 in your pew Bible. And as you guessed from Kim's children's sermon, it's a parable of the lost son. Luke 15. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeying your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered his property with prostitutes, comes home, you killed the fatted calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.'" Do you ever take things for granted? Think about that. Take electricity, for instance, until the ice storm shuts it down, or your car until that one morning when it simply won't start. How about your job or your health? Sunshine, maybe, that's a biggie, or blue sky even. Taking things for granted is really quite common, you know, and far too often we don't even notice until something's gone. Lost sheep, for instance, or a lost coin. So can you think of a time when you were taken for granted? How did that feel? Or can you remember a time when you took someone else for granted? Because that feels the very same way. Picture your grandkids until they crawl up in your lap and say, "I love you," or mom and dad until they get that doctor's report. How about your son or daughter till they go off to college, or your prodigal son or daughter who headed off in a bad direction? Can you think of anyone right now who you've written off, or who, for whatever reason, has written you off? What should you do about that? Paul, in his letter to the church in Corinth, says, "From now on, regard no one from a worldly point of view." In other words, now that you're a Christian, only look at people through a heavenly lens, from a heavenly perspective. If you follow Jesus, like you say you do, then you need to see people through Jesus' eyes. And notice who Jesus hangs out with in Scripture. tax collectors and sinners, notorious sinners, according to the New Living Translation. Jesus breaks bread with the lowest of the low, right? Which I have to tell you is great news for me. But notice that he eats with the upper echelon of society as well, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. And notice that in scripture, we see that behavior time and time again. Jesus traveled with Matthew, remember? For years, a tax collector. And with Judas, a betrayer and a thief. Peter was there too, a simple fisherman, not exactly a white-collar guy, a man who later denied even knowing him. Jesus went to the home of Zacchaeus, remember? A chief tax collector and a crooked one at that. He healed the servant of a Roman centurion, a commander of an occupying army. Think Vladimir Putin in Ukraine. Jesus even commended that foreign commander for his faith. Jesus hangs out with everyone. Scribes and Pharisees, Sadducees and teachers of the law, workers and laborers and politicians, a broad swath of society, those on the left and those on the right and all those so-called moderates in the middle are all welcomed by our Lord with open arms. It's scandalous, really, don't you think? Everyone's acceptable. I mean, how many times does Jesus cross over the Sea of Galilee and go over to the Gentile side of the lake? Jesus welcomes everyone. The old and affirmed women and children, rich and poor, clean and unclean. No one is beyond his grace. He doesn't accept all behavior, of course, or all choices. He often tells people that they need to repent. Go and sin no more is also a very common theme, but he welcomes anyone and everyone who desires a personal relationship with Almighty God. So what does that say? And what does it say to us in light of Paul's command to not regard anyone from a worldly point of view? Who would you say is acceptable in the eyes of God and therefore acceptable to you as well? Who's worth reaching out to, searching for, welcoming, calling back home? Do you realize that includes you? Our lesson today starts out with, then Jesus told this parable. He actually shares three, but for some reason, the lectionary skips the first two. Maybe scholars thought that the reading would be too long, and with a sermon following, everyone would surely be asleep. The first parable is about lost sheep, maybe you remember, and about a loving shepherd who searches diligently to find it. The herdsman leaves 99 other sheep, faithful, obedient sheep, all alone, out in the open country, just grazing away without a care in the world, and heads off to find a single stray. That's not exactly a good business model. Think return on investment. 99 versus one. What if that one sheep was a rebellious rascal, more like a stubborn old goat, really, one who has a history of wandering off? Would that matter? What if that one sheep was out searching for greener pastures? Sheep have a tendency to do that, you know, and the grass is always greener on the other side, particularly over the septic tank. What if that sheep was scrawny or old or didn't produce much wool? Or what if that sheep was a prize-winning sheep or the family favorite? Would any of that matter? I don't think so. Not with this shepherd. I don't think anything in that sheep's character would change a thing. In fact, I think that's the point. The shepherd leaves 99 others who could easily get into trouble while he's gone, and he seeks out the one who's lost. Doesn't abandon even one, regardless. No one's taken for granted. The second parable is about a woman with a lost coin. She has 10 of them, we're told, so some scholars suggest that this was her wedding dowry. If so, it has great sentimental value in addition to financial worth. Others say that it was a gift from her husband, all she has left after his death. I find that interesting, but it seems to me like it's reading into the text. Still, others say that it was simply money that was set aside for household expenses. But does any of that really matter either? Regardless of its significance, this lady's not about to take a lost coin for granted, is she? She lights the lamp, she looks under the bed, she sweeps the entire house, and when she finds it, we're told she rejoices. We have two fairly short, pointed parables, maybe as a warm-up to the third. And it, the prodigal son, is pretty well known. It's been suggested that if we lost the entire written word of God and only retained this one parable, we could still grasp the gospel truth, God's grace and forgiveness. You think that's true? Parables can be powerful. They're short stories that illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson. A parable is a teaching aid, if you will, an extended analogy, an inspired comparison, an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. The word parable comes from the Latin meaning comparison. But in the original Greek, you have the word para, meaning beside, and ballo, meaning to cast or throw. A parable is a story that is cast alongside of a truth in order to illustrate that truth. I like that. Jesus told many stories in the form of parables. It says in Matthew 13:3. Mark 4:34 says that in his public ministry, he never taught without using parables, and that he explained these, quote, when he was alone with his disciples. And according to Matthew 12, he did this to reveal truth to those who were willing to hear it and to hide truth from those who were indifferent. I like that too, I think. There are parables in the Old Testament as well. Did you know that? In 2 Samuel 12, Nathan tells David a parable about a rich man who stole a poor man's sheep to illustrate David's sin with Bathsheba. And Proverbs 22 casts the image of a roaring lion alongside that of a king's fury. A furious king doesn't actually turn into a roaring lion, does he? But he's rather like a roaring lion. Like I said, parables are stories that illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson. So maybe it might be helpful for us to have some rules to interpret them. Let me suggest a few. First, determine what's really being talked about. The kingdom of heaven is like, or Jesus told this story to those confident in their own righteousness who look down on others. Second, distinguish the meat of the story versus what's simply ornamentation. In other words, not everything in a parable carries a deep spiritual meaning. Some details are simply there to make the story more vivid or memorable or more realistic. For instance, in Jesus' own interpretation of the parable of the sower, he doesn't comment on the fact that there are only four different types of soil instead of many. That detail is actually meaningless to the overall point. And third, always interpret scripture with scripture. That's critical. Jesus' parables will never contradict the rest of the word of God. Jesus even says in John 12:49, I did not come to speak on my own, but the Father who sent me commanded me to say all that I've spoken. The plea, he who has ears to hear, then, is a call to listen for the truth, to listen to the parable as one seeking truth directly from God. So with that in mind, Jesus tells a parable. There was a man who had two sons. Again, the prodigal son's pretty familiar, so we might easily take it for granted. But with three parables in a row, all making the same point, the value of things, would that actually be wise? Besides, I remember an old pastor when I was growing up saying, if the literal sense makes common sense, don't look for another sense. So, two sons have grown up together on the family estate. They've eaten together from the bounty of the land, bask in the abundant blessings of a privileged life. They were born in the promised land among God's chosen people to a wealthy family. They're religious too, and we know this because they are adhering to strict Jewish laws. Every aspect of life was detailed for the Hebrew people, which included things like inheritance laws. And when a man died, the law was very specific. It stipulated that all of his possessions were to be distributed to his sons. Daughters didn't get a thing other than possibly a wedding dowry. Neither did wives or parents or close friends. By law, the oldest son was entitled to a double share, which some historians suggest was twice as much as all the other brothers combined. But others say it was simply a double portion. But in this case, even that doesn't matter. There are only two sons, so the math is exactly the same. And this double share law was so ingrained in the religious culture that it even applied in cases of divorce and multiple marriages. Deuteronomy 21:17 says, a man must acknowledge the son of his unloved wife as the firstborn by giving him a double share of all he has. So picture the scenario. The younger son, a spoiled brat, I think, obviously feels entitled. He has no intention of working for a living, at least not in the family business, so he crafts a get-rich-quick scheme. Maybe he plans to live on Easy Street the rest of his life, you know, living off the family nest egg. So he eventually works up his courage, waltzes up to his father, maybe slams his fist on the table just for added effect, and demands his share of the inheritance. Being the second son, he's entitled to a third of everything, a third of his father's entire estate by law. Only problem is, dad's not dead yet. So how would you feel if you were that father? Betrayed? Rejected? Can you imagine the tension in the room? Do you think that's how God feels with us when we act entitled? Just give me the money, Dad. Pour out your blessings. I want what's coming to me, and I want it now. I don't want some future promise. I'm not looking for you to add my name to the title on the farm. I want to be cashed out immediately. Refinance the ranch if you have to. Sell something. I don't care what you have to do. I'm going to decide my own life from now on. I don't need you, and I don't want you meddling in my affairs. Maybe it's even more direct. You're obviously not going to kick the bucket anytime soon, which is what I would prefer. So how about paying me anyway? Let's pretend you're already dead, okay? Just give me everything that I have coming and I'll be on my way. I don't want you or anything to do with you. I just want what you can give me. What would be going through your mind if you were the parent of that willful child? Would you feel unloved? Taken for granted? Obviously betrayed? I gotta tell you, I'd be devastated, brokenhearted, followed immediately by mad, really mad. Who in the world does this little punk think he is? I mean, my gosh. It would be difficult, wouldn't it, to have such a willful child? But the father goes ahead and blesses his son, gives him a third of everything, takes his worldly possessions, one third of everything that he's worked for his entire life, and hands it over as if he were dead. The younger son is, in effect, saying, you don't matter to me. And yet the father responds with self-giving, sacrificial love. I think for most of us, it's pretty easy to see ourselves in the role of the prodigal, at least if we're honest. We've all, at one time or another, let our parents down or disappointed a loved one. We can probably all remember times when we completely disregarded the feelings of others and only thought about ourselves. I'll bet there are instances when we wasted precious resources or outright squandered them on things that were not so good for us. We all know what it means to be a selfish brat. I also think that most of us know what it feels like to take our relationship with the Lord for granted, to, in effect, snub our noses at our Heavenly Father, take our blessings and walk away only to squander them as we see fit. I think it's safe to say that many of us have willfully walked out of the presence of the Lord only to venture into foreign lands of high living. Just give me the blessings, God. I'll pick my own friends. I'm going to decide for myself how I'll live. I'll be the one in charge from now on. In fact, from now on, I'll just treat you as if you're dead. We know the life of the prodigal, don't we? But do we comprehend the magnitude of the Father's love? Because I wonder. I think it's something we take for granted, don't you? And I don't think that we can understand the depth of his love until we first understand the depth of his pain. To comprehend this unconditional love, we need to feel the agony of the betrayal. To even touch on the concept of forgiveness and reconciliation, we have to see the rejection. That knife thrust into the father's heart by his own child, who he loves with every fiber of his being, must have been excruciating, don't you think? We know that the son runs off to live the high life in a foreign land, and that after a while, things aren't going so well, which is often the case with us prodigals. He blew all his money and had to actually get a job. The only one he qualified for, though, was feeding pigs. That must have been quite a change for this privileged boy raised in wealth and comfort on the family estate. Now he's hungry and lonely and living literally in a pigsty. Now remember, to Jews, pigs are considered unclean. So anyone coming into contact with a pig is also considered ritually and therefore spiritually unclean. And by law, an unclean person is not allowed to attend worship on the Sabbath, let alone offer sacrifices for their sins. This young man is lost, completely cut off, out of money, separated from his family and friends, but he's also separated from his faith. He's separated from God in every possible way. He's separated from salvation. Because of his chosen lifestyle, he's effectively created a wall between himself and Almighty God. It's no wonder we can relate. We too have made decisions or lifestyle choices that separate us from the Father. Can you feel the anguish here? When he finally comes to his senses, this willful child repents and turns away from sinful living. Finally, enough stuff has taken place that the young man clearly sees the situation he's in. He even looks back and compares his life with where he used to be. Life in the presence of a loving father and in the company of a supporting family is far better than starving to death with a bunch of pigs. So he says to himself, I'll get up from here and go back to my father. I'll confess that I've sinned. Repentance is a definite mark of returned prodigals. It's not easy, but if you want to come home, it's the first step. Like I said, we know the story, right? Our young man, hungry and humble, finally makes his way back to the father. I can almost hear him practicing his confession as he walks down the road. Dad, I blew it. I was only thinking of myself. Can you imagine the fear in his heart and the questions that must have been going through his mind? What if he doesn't take me in? What if he chases me off? What if he says he doesn't love me like I did to him by walking out? What would you say if you were the father? What would you do? Punish him? Banish him? Chain him up in the barn? Would you turn your back on him? I mean, he did take a third of your entire life savings. He squandered it on wine, women, and song. Doesn't even asking for his inheritance imply that he wishes you were dead? So how would you respond? A lecture? Some form of penance? He's put you through a lot. You got to do something, right? And the father does. He runs to meet the boy. He hikes up his robe and kicks off his sandals, a most unbecoming act for a wealthy landowner. He sprints to his wayward son with open arms, and before the boy can even get his complete apology out, the father instructs the servants to put a robe on his shoulders and a ring on his finger. He puts fresh sandals on his feet. That signifies that he's welcome, right? A robe and fresh sandals. And the ring says that you're part of the family again. The father continues to love his child unconditionally, no matter how far the prodigal has strayed, no matter what he has done in the past. It's not enough to separate him from the love of the father. Wayward children like you and me are always welcome back in the family, always invited to come back home. Like I said, it's a familiar story. Might be easy to take it for granted. We've heard it before, heard it preached from several different angles. How'd the older brother feel when the younger one was welcomed back? The rest of the estate was his, right? How did he feel giving up one of his fatted calves or a robe or a ring, especially after coming in from the fields from a full day's worth of work? Maybe he felt taken for granted. Notice, though, that the father goes to him as well and begs him to come and join the celebration. Even the servants are invited to come. Everyone's welcome in the family. No one is regarded from a worldly point of view. The celebration just isn't complete until the entire family is home. Which is why it's called good news. And all of God's people said, amen. I invite you to listen for the Holy Spirit nudging your hearts as we stand and sing. Will you please stand? Thank you. Each week we come together as a family of God and we share with one another both our joys and concerns and lift them up before the Lord in prayer. There are a number of prayer requests on the back of your bulletin, and I invite you to take these folks with you and to pray for them by name. I have a couple of additions. Bob Odell is preaching at our sister church in Cadillac today. I'd like to pray for safety and travels and strength while he's preaching. He's still dealing with COVID stuff, so we'd like to keep him lifted up. Also, Carol Gunderson, Nona Nugent's daughter, is getting ready to go home and be with her Lord, so we'd like to keep her in our prayers. She passed away. Okay. Carol has gone home to be with her Lord. I saw her on Friday. So thank you, Diane. Are there others? Little Lenny? Didn't he just pass his real estate test on? Well, I'm glad he got the test done. Keep him lifted up. Thank you. It's nice to see your smiling face. By the way, Lenny passed his real estate test too. Seeing no others, could we be in a spirit of silent prayer with one another, please? Almighty and compassionate Lord, eternal God, receive the silent prayers that we've just shared. And please receive those that still lay heavily on our hearts, as well as those that will become manifest in the days ahead. Lift us up, Lord, and sustain us with the power of your Holy Spirit. Guide our every step and direct our paths so that we'll be your ambassadors. A light of hope in an ever-darkening world. Father, we worship you and we praise you because you are our Lord and our salvation. We accept your deep, unconditional love that is so freely offered to each one of us. And we reach out now with open hearts to grasp your outstretched hand of forgiveness. Please strengthen us as we do. Lord, we all carry burdens. And the weight of these hardships is something that we wish to lay down now on your altar of grace. And we all have moments of joy and blessings directly from your own hand. And these celebrations we wish to place before your throne as well. For we know that you're in control of each and every aspect of our lives. We know that your love is indeed deep and unconditional. And we know that all things ultimately work together for our good and for your glory. Father, as a family, we pray for our world and for our church, for your world and your church. We pray for our leaders and for our nation. We pray for ourselves and for our loved ones. And we pray for each of your people, especially Bob Bodell and the family and friends of Carol Gunderson and for Lenny Merrill. For those who are on our prayer list and those who are silently on our hearts even now. Please grant healing and comfort and peace in ways that only you can do. Please fill each one of your people with your Holy Spirit and empower us to obediently do your will. And please heal and guide your church, Lord, in all of its many manifestations throughout the world. Cause us, your ambassadors, to reach out to each other, and especially to those who do not yet know your Son. We ask this in his name and pray as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're Christ ambassadors, it says in our first reading this morning, as though God were making his appeal through us. And so from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. What a powerful declaration. When we share communion on a weekly basis, we make a similar statement to the world. When we eat with sinners and tax collectors, as well as the religious and political elite, we claim that everyone is loved by God. When Catholics and Baptists and Lutherans and Methodists and Presbyterians and disciples all break bread together, we proclaim what this world is intended to be like. So come, with all your differences and all your frailties and all your hopes and all your dreams, come and break down walls.
If you, O God, held our sins and fears, our compromises and cowardices against us, who could stand? But you are a forgiving God. You hear us when we cry out to you to lead us to a joyous place. We come to this table with eagerness and longing, realizing that it is a taste of the heavenly communion that you promised to all of us. Amen.
Amen. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." Likewise, after supper, he took a cup, and after giving thanks for it, he gave this to his disciples, and he said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sin. These things do in remembrance of me." Just everyone who believes Jesus is the Christ is welcome at this table. Come forward, break off a small piece of bread, dip it in the cup and partake, and then gather around the sanctuary for our closing benediction. Or if you prefer, there are some prepackaged communion sets in the chairs in front of you. But come, all things are now ready.
Thank you.
I'd like to remind you that elders are available to talk with you or pray for you after this service, that if today's not convenient, they would love to hear from you throughout the week. Today's benediction is really more closing thoughts than benediction. I couldn't help it. In the story of the prodigal son, there's a key word in verse 12 that is very often overlooked. It says, he divided his property between them. The fatted calf for the feast, the sandals placed on the younger boy's feet, the ring and the robe, all belonged to the older son. He'd earned it. He was worked hard for it. He stayed faithful and close to his father all these years. So one uncomfortable way of looking at this is that for the younger son to be restored, reconciled, some of the stuff that rightly belonged to the older son needed to be spent. Most of us have worked hard. We've earned what we have. We've got a lot of good stuff and we deserve it, including time. But what if letting go of what is rightfully ours could restore a lost brother or sister? Would that bring us joy? I know it would bring joy to our Father. Imagine being the answer to someone's prayer.